So, EDI, does that word sound familiar to you? If not, my name is Hiba Daghar, and I'm a PhD candidate in neuroscience working in rare diseases, and I'm here to break that down for you. E, it refers to different members, participants of a community that needs to be treated fairly. It helps us to create an equal environment where our opportunities are there. That's equity. D, it refers to the differences in terms of mode of expressions, conditions, or experiences of individuals from different groups. That's diversity. And I, it refers to creating a philosophy and an environment that embraces, highlights these differences. That's inclusivity. Research can respond to all those criteria by being inclusive. A good example could be by the people who are doing this research. Trainees, staff, or researchers can come from different backgrounds, have different origins, sex, gender, and expertise. That leads to diverse perspectives when it comes to solve a complicated issue, and diverse perspectives would bring diverse solutions. And we like that in science. Multidisciplinary research, for example, is a good one. We can have chemists, biologists, doctors, engineers that can come together to solve very complex issues. Research can also be inclusive, and that's why rare diseases are interesting. So, when it comes to rare diseases, in Canada, for example, 6.7% of newborns are labeled as rare conditions. Unfortunately, when it comes to funds or research money, it goes to more prevalent diseases. We can think about Alzheimer's, diabetes, or obesity, for example. In this case, there's a part of the population that tends to be discriminated because of the nature of the condition they have. With this challenge, we have two problems. First one, no therapies are available for these people. And second, there is no research or further understanding into the different mechanisms that are involved in those diseases. And that's where we have to think about cheaper ways to fund research and more efficient models or research pipelines. In the case of rare disorders, more specifically, most conditions are known as genetic conditions. And that means that the disease is caused by changes in the genes. And in most cases, unfortunately, it affects newborns or babies. That also means that we can't allow ourselves to wait 20, 25 years to develop a drug from start. In our lab, we try to develop something that we like calling translational research. And to do that, we use our favorite animal model, which is the C. elegans. So as you can see here, the C. elegans is a little worm model, 1 millimeter length, it is transparent, and genetically speaking, it's very close to humans. What we can do with that is very cool. We can use very specific human mutations and put them in the worms, mimic them, and have kind of humanized avatars of our different conditions. Because worms are much cheaper than other models, such as mice, for example, we can use them to develop different pipelines to, one, find potential therapies, but also understands the different mechanisms of several diseases. In this case, what we do in our lab is that we have a drug library of 4,000 molecules that are already exist in the market. So think about it. We have a drug library of molecules that exist in the pharmacy that we all know. That means one thing, we can use them in a drug repurposing approach. So what we do when we have our humanized avatar in our worm is that we do a drug screen. So we test randomly these 4,000 molecules and we try to see which one of those are able to improve the disease condition in our worm. In this way, we're able to identify potential therapies. And that's very cool because we make it very much cheaper and less long for patients. On the other hand, we're doing research, right? So we like to understand the mechanisms that underlie these diseases. As I told you earlier, most conditions are known as genetic ones. Basically, what that means is that we know what are the mutation or what's the change in the gene that causes the disease. However, because there's so few patients who are diagnosed with these conditions, we don't really know what are the mechanisms underlying those disorders. And that's where AI or computational can be very useful. So from the data that we extract from our drug screening, we can generate figures that look like this. And don't freak out, it's not that complicated. I'll explain this for you. So here, I'll try to use this, perfect. So on one end, we have the drugs. So let's say a list of hundreds or thousands of drugs that kind of improve the health of our worm model, right? What we can do, because I told you that the drugs we use are clinically approved, we know them, we know that they are safe in patients, and we know what are their targets. We can use the databases available for those drugs in order to identify what are the targets. The bars you see here are enrichment scores. Basically, what that means is that the longer the bar, the higher the target is enriched. In this heat map, we try to identify what we call clusters to be able to understand what are the targets that kind of help us understand the disease mechanism. So what we're looking for in this type of figure is brighter or lighter squares like this. When we have a square like this, it means that all these drugs from this group tend to have a similar target. And this is very cool because we can go back to this cluster, look at those drugs, look at their targets, and boom, we potentially identified new targets for our disease. This is a computational approach, but you can imagine that we can have an unlimited number of genes, unlimited number of proteins or receptors that can also be labeled as targets. This can be used in different type of diseases, but also using much bigger drug libraries. The one we have is a 4,000 drug one, but we can use hundreds of thousands. Using this pipeline, we try to close the gap in research by one, trying to find potential therapies, and two, trying to understand the real mechanisms behind several diseases. And like this, we can suggest new mechanisms that will help understand the physiopathology or the mechanisms of these diseases. So we all tend to freak out when it comes to AI, thinking that it might control us. We're doing research here, so we try to help patients and rare disease communities and try to be inclusive in our research as much as we can. Thank you, everyone, and I would like to thank ChatGPT for writing this talk for me. Yeah, have a good day.